We are frequently told that passing too much urine or polyuria, drinking too much water or polydipsia, and eating too much foods or polyphagia are the main symptoms of diabetes. However, these three polys are nonspecific and unnoticeable in early stages of the disease. So, never wait for these symptoms to come. Instead, look for symptoms of insulin resistance, since it's a precursor to diabetes and often associated with more specific symptoms that let us detect it in its early stages. With insulin resistance, our cells don't respond well to insulin hormone. This causes insulin-producing cells in pancreas gland to work harder and produce excess insulin, to keep blood glucose under control. The overproduction of insulin by the pancreas is called hyperinsulinemia. If left untreated, it can progress to overt diabetes. In this video, we want to go through 5 top conditions warning us about insulin resistance, hyperinsulinemia, and subsequent diabetes. If you have any of them, seek medical attention immediately. First is acanthosis nigricans. It's a skin condition that appears with coarse brown or black patches. It typically affects body folds and creases like armpits, elbow pits, neck and groin. The patches look velvety and warty and thicker than the surrounding skin. Lesions may have a dirt-like appearance as well, but skin scrubbing or using bleachers do not work and may even irritate lesions. Metformin, topical and oral retinoids and weight loss are top 3 effective treatments. However, complete cure is difficult to achieve. Second is acrocordon. It's a medical term for skin tags. They are marked by small, soft and fleshy bumps on normal skin that look like deflated balloons. They have small stalks that attach them to the skin. Most skin tags are skin-colored and range in size from a few millimeters up to 5 centimeters. They form when the skin rubs against itself repetitively, so are often seen in sites of friction. They often grow on the neck, armpits, groins, eyelids and under the breast. Nearly half of adults experience at least one single skin tag in their lifetime. So, it is often a benign skin condition, but having numerous skin tags can be an early sign of diabetes. Both acanthosis nigricans and skin tags are common signs of insulin resistance. That's because hyperinsulinemia causes skin cells, particularly keratinocytes and dermal fibroblasts, to proliferate. This promotes development of acanthosis nigricans and skin tags in affected patients. So any patient with these skin lesions must be carefully and regularly screened for diabetes. Third is polycystic ovarian syndrome. During insulin resistance, hyperinsulinemia affects ovaries in females, encouraging ovaries to generate a male sex hormone called androgen in excess. Excessive androgen is one of the key inducers of polycystic ovarian syndrome. High androgen levels can produce various symptoms. Affected women often present with missed, irregular, or very light menstrual periods. Signs of high levels of androgens including excess body hair known as hirsutism, acne or oily skin, and bilateral enlarged ovaries containing multiple small follicles on sonography. Only 2 of these need to be present to diagnose the disease. Studies have shown that 50 to 75% of obese adolescents with this syndrome develop insulin resistance. Besides, nearly 10% of affected patients finally develop diabetes by age 40. Next is abdominal obesity. It happens when excess visceral fat builds up in our body. What we mean by visceral fat is fat stored within the abdominal cavity and surrounds internal organs like stomach, liver, and intestines. It is also known as active fat, since it's an active player in how hormones, including insulin, function. Studies have shown that excess visceral fat can induce insulin resistance. That's because too much visceral fat can produce and release various pro-inflammatory chemicals such as leptin, adiponectin, and interleukin-6. These chemicals are known to trigger liver and systemic resistance to the action of insulin. So, it can cause serious health problems, overt diabetes in particular. On the other hand, hyperinsulinemia can cause weight gain since insulin is an anabolic hormone. Waist circumference is typically used to estimate visceral fat. To correctly measure it, wrap a tape measure around the widest part of your abdomen, level with your navel. Make sure it's not too tight and that it's straight, even at the back. In general, waist circumference more than 102 mm in men and more than 88 mm in women increase the risk for developing insulin resistance and diabetes. But recent studies suggest that optimal waist circumference mainly depends on your body mass index. This table provides waist circumference thresholds considering body mass index. For example, Waist circumference above 80 for women with normal weight is considered high. It's very handy. Take a screenshot and keep it on your phone. Next is gestational diabetes. It's a type of diabetes that develops in pregnancy, usually in the second and third trimesters. Gestational diabetes doesn't mean you already had diabetes before you got pregnant. Normally, all pregnant women have some insulin resistance during pregnancy. However, some women have insulin resistance even before they get pregnant, making them much more prone to developing diabetes in pregnancy. Gestational diabetes often disappears after giving birth. However, about 50% of affected women go on to develop type 2 diabetes in coming years. So, any women recalling a history of high blood sugar during pregnancy needs to be screened for type 2 diabetes regularly. Besides, if you want to know how diabetes affects our nerves and produces diabetic neuropathy, watch the next video.